Welcome back to the Unwit and Hour DSI YouTube channel, the home of album reviews, discography guides and think pieces. You can catch me on air at Drystone Radio, 103.5 FM, 6pm UK time. So for today's video I thought we'd do something a little bit different because I was working on my John Paul review and I am going to post that eventually just when my vinyl arrives because I know that certain people in the comments are sad that they can't see the vinyl spinning, but so I thought for today we'd do something a little bit different and I'd talk to you about a scene that over the last few months especially I have become quite immersed in, and that is the very niche scene of Slipknot collectorism. So we can't really talk about the Slipknot collector scene without first talking about mfkr1.com. So I thought to start off I'd give you a little bit of my history with them, if you will, to start you off. So basically what they do is they are a website that gives archival information on Slipknot from before 1999, so that would be from 1995 to 1999. So how I first stumbled upon them was I was finding Slipknot and I was really getting into their music, but I don't know what it is with me, I think it's the same with most people. When you first discover a band you want to go, I wonder what they did first, let me go and check that out. So after a bit of digging, I dug up on mfkr1.com, and for me, like, my mind was just blown because I only thought that Slipknot were around from 1999 and I had no idea that they'd done stuff before that. Like, I'd read about it but I didn't think they really did anything, but you know, as soon as I found mfkr1 it was like a whole new world just opened. Like, I remember first seeing, I think it was a live video for the song Windows, and my mind just being completely blown. And if you went onto the discography page of their website, you could see all of the demos fully listed there that they had done before. Now, some of them were fully leaked, like the 1997 three-track EP, and Make Feed Kill Repeat obviously was there, and but for me, the one true holy grail of collectorism in my mind at that point was the 1995 four-track demo, which contained two tracks that, in my view, or at least in my knowledge to that point, had never seen the light of day, and those were Fur and Part of Me. So knowing that there were many people who had heard about this demo and maybe had come across it, I started digging and I found out that MFKR1 themselves had actually sold one to a guy. I can only remember that his name was I think, if I can't remember correctly, but so I went on r/Slipknot to see if anyone else maybe had them or had some kind of knowledge of how to obtain them. So I went on and said, has anyone got or know of anyone with the 1995 demo? And so I eventually got in to talks with a guy on the Slipknot subreddit called and he basically ran me round in circles for days. So basically I would ask him, like, oh, do you know if there's anyone who could tell me about these things or how you could get them, or, and he basically would give me the most vague answers possible. He's like, well, I can't really disclose people and they're very hard to, so I'm like, okay, can you give me some details on a few of the tracks? And he'd be like, oh yeah, sure, and I'd be like, do you have them? And he's like, no, I don't, but it turns out later on that he actually probably did. So basically I spent the last 3 days of my life at that point being run around in circles by a random guy on the internet, so I just called it quits. So I was going about my life until one day, probably about, was it 4 or 5 months later, let me just check. So as you'll see here, I initially made the post searching for the demo 10 months ago at the time that this is being recorded, and the guy who eventually came around to negotiating with me, hit me up around... So the guy who I was buying the demo off of hit me up a full 6 months later. So keep in mind, I'd pretty much forgotten that I even asked about it at this point. But then obviously, I was thinking this was a bit sketchy. I'm thinking, you're saying you have it and you're trying to scam me out of money. So I said, oh, send me some previews on Dropbox. But lo and behold, they came and my little mind was blown. But along with the $2.95 demo tracks, I also managed to purchase a studio version of the songs Windows. And May 17th. Windows being the first pre-Corey Slipknot song I'd ever heard, and May 17th I always thought sounded cool, so it was amazing to have these songs in my possession, and when I heard them, oh boy, they were fantastic, and it felt really weird because it was almost, it didn't hit me, but it was like I was listening to it and then I thought, only a select few people in the world have these. Like, it felt really cool. It felt like you were part of an exclusive club or something. So I could definitely see why collectors were, you know, why these items were so coveted in collector circles. All that said though, there was a part of me that kind of wanted to just share these songs with the world just because of how amazing they were. But I agreed to keep it under wraps because the guy who eventually sold them to me basically said, listen, I don't really want people trying to, like, begging me to sell it to them. So, you know, I agreed. I said, you look, I'll keep it under wraps. It's fine. I mean, you know, I showed it to one or two friends, but only to be like, okay, cool. These Slipknot songs I have, you can listen to them. But it turns out that they wouldn't be kept under wraps for too much longer. On the 30th of January 2020, a YouTube user by the name of Blackheart uploaded the entire of Slipknot's 1995 demo onto YouTube. And to be fair, I was sat there a bit perplexed and simultaneously annoyed that I spent 30 quid on something I could have just waited a month for and then listened to for free. But alas, there was a part of me that was actually quite happy that the world was finally getting to hear these. But I thought, you know, it's because the copyright is going to be taken down. But lo and behold, it persisted. But then I went and looked on his YouTube page, and it turned out that he'd started his YouTube channel just a few days prior to posting it. So me, along with a lot of other people on the r/Slipknot subreddit, were quite confused. Rightfully so, I think. I mean, it's not as if we were at all confused by the leak, really. I mean, the silver disc leak happened only like a month before, if that. So if anything, we were almost expecting it in a way, but the fact that he started his YouTube channel almost, it seemed specifically for that, was really confusing. But over the coming days, more demos just kept coming and coming and coming and coming. So there was, all as well as the 1995 demo, he also leaked the entirety of excerpts from current projects where Windows and May 17th were from, the first ever videoed Slipknot show from 1996. Okay, I might as well give some clarification here. I meant to say the first full videoed Slipknot show, as it has come to my attention, as I'll tell you at the end of the video, that there is in fact some video footage from their first ever gig in 1995. So yeah, just thought I'd clear that up. As well as the entirety of the gold disc, which is like, you think that like the silver disc was rare? This, I'm pretty sure this even pipped the 1995 demo in levels of rareness. Like, you could not find this thing anywhere. And yet here this guy was leaking basically a new entire full demo every single day for like 2 weeks. So a lot of people within the Slipknot community were confused. Like, why would this guy come out of nowhere to just have a massive leak dump on us? I mean, let's be fair here. We weren't complaining. Like, this was years and years and years. Like, this is thousands of dollars of material literally all dumped on us in the space of like a week and a half. Like, this was unheard of. So we were wondering, what's this guy doing this for? But if you went into his video descriptions, you would very clearly see why. If you went into his video descriptions, there it was. In essence, Blackheart's mission statement, and it basically stated that the reason that the leak dump was happening was because he became increasingly annoyed at the community of Slipknot collectors who were basically hoarders, for lack of a better word. Like, they would purposefully, like, hide the demos from people, not share them, like, just basically keep it to themselves for the sake of feeling special, which, even for me, when I had them and, you know, I wasn't allowed to, you know, share them with people, I felt really, really bad not being able to do that, because it was such great music that I really felt, almost felt a need to share it with people. But me, I couldn't really see why people would want to keep it for themselves, other than the reason for just feeling special, I guess. And neither could Blackheart, really. But there it was, Blackheart was leaking and leaking and leaking and leaking for actually longer than I thought it was. It was about a month until, in February, disaster struck. Blackheart's channel was terminated and taken down, which a lot of us saw coming, but we couldn't really see the reason why. Like, there was no reason these demos would be copyrighted. Like, I understand that, you know, Slipknot might be touchy about having them out, but they've even said themselves that they don't reflect what Slipknot are about now. So I don't see why they would see the need to take it down necessarily. But there it was, his channel was no more. But thank God for YouTube re-uploads, because now we still have them all. But then what these elite collectors didn't quite realise is that the appearance of Blackheart sparked an almost communist revolution within the Slipknot collectors community. And basically it became, you know, oh, we need to hear the demos. If we've been fans for this long, we need to hear them. And then the elitist collectors kind of fired back with, well, surely it's elitism if you think you need to hear them. But I think that really, if we're being honest, if you've been a fan of a band for so long that you've gone to a length to A, subscribe to their subreddit, B, keep in track with stuff that happened before they were even signed to a label, C, bother to actively seek it out and ask questions about it, then I think it probably is warranted. So yeah, I guess you could say that the arrival of Blackheart was somewhat of a rallying cry for people like this, and in honesty, me as well. But little did these elitists know, one of the biggest happenings in the Slipknot collectors community was just around the corner. Now, I can't remember this entirely well, but it's, if I can remember correctly, just mere days after Blackheart's channel was taken down, the entire of the MFKR1 website just shut down. Like, it just completely went, it was gone. Like, literally, I was just browsing the Slipknot Reddit until I say, oh, MFKR1's over. And if you went onto their website, all you would see was a screenshot that said, Killers acquired, like, the Breath of the Wind 1999 to 2020, which, if you didn't know already, was a lyric from Slipknot's Killers Acquired off of MFKR. And while there were a few people who were like, oh, MFKR1's over, oh no, there was a surprising amount of people who were actually really, really pleased that this had happened. And to me, this was quite shocking, because I wasn't really all too familiar with the inner workings of MFKR1, but apparently it came to a lot of people that when it came to elitist collectors, MFKR1 were at the epicenter of this kind of behaviour. According to many people that I had spoken to, they as well had hoarded multiple demos, live shows, and all sorts of other stuff from the fan base.
Now, I think that this needs a bit of clarification again. What I meant was, people were saying stuff like, while they had demos and videos and stuff in their possession, for some reason they just didn't feel like uploading it to their website, because apparently everything is released in due time, which really doesn't make much sense, but oh well.
Even though it is their job as an archive website to have as much stuff as possible to show to people. So, you know, if I'm honest, this revelation made me kind of angry that I even respected MFKR1 in the first place. And oh boy, the elitists came in full force with this one, with all the people rallying around to basically have a laugh that MFKR1 was over, and basically have a go at them for being elitists, which, good. You had a few people who were not very happy with people being so happy that MFKR1 was terminated, and oh, it was the elitists, and in particular, a guy called which you might remember I talked about earlier as the guy who basically ran me round in circles for days trying to find the 1995 demo originally. And he was posting underneath people's comments saying stuff like, oh, it's sad that people are like this, it's sad that people think that they have the right to hear stuff.
As well as a load of stuff about copyright and the rest of the community having victim complexes, which... it was all a bit stupid, really.
So I was just completely done at this point. I'm sat there thinking, listen, you are a guy who, like, along with the MFKR1 guys probably, are just salty because you have a lack of exclusivity, and so just decide to rain on everyone else's parade, and then basically when anything good happens, just go, you don't really deserve it, you're not a proper fan, you don't spend money to hear this stuff. And I'm thinking, well, even if we wanted to spend money, you wouldn't let us, because you would even, like, try to deflect the fact that you had them in the first place. But I get the fact that you might be thinking, well, you're a Slipknot collector, stuff like this to you is probably a big deal. Which, yes, it is, but I've even shown people who aren't even fans of Slipknot all these events, and even they have pretty much admitted that the amount of exclusivity, like, hogging collectors and just complete snobbery going on is just not making them look good at all. And I even have a friend who can testify to that. So, mate, I was talking to you about a month ago about, like, the just sheer amount of, like basically just elitist within, like, the Slipknot collectors community. And I know that people, like, a lot of people think that just because we're collectors it's a big deal to us, but I know that even you were kind of shocked by the amount of people who just were clawing for any amount of exclusivity they could get, really.
Yeah, well, people are going to be elitist about things that, I assume you're talking about, like, unreleased, or like, unreleased tracks, unreleased albums.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, demo.
Yeah.
Like, demos. So people will have them because it puts their, what, something in their collection, whether it's physical copy. It's probably better if it's a physical copy, because that's something that can't be transferred. But, like, a digital, it still counts with a digital copy. Having a copy of something puts their collection at the top. Like, they have something that no one else has. So that's probably why there's a lot of elitists. Yeah. And it's, with music, it's very, because a lot more unreleased things are going to survive. Mm. A lot more demos are going to be less accessible.
Yeah.
So rip that stuff onto.
Yeah. I mean, I know that when I showed you all of the stuff about, like, MFKR1 getting shutting down and stuff, you found the amount of, like, elitist people, like, complaining that basically a load of people who were like, we need to hear the demos, like, basically calling us all communists. And, like, even you found that stuff really, really ridiculous.
Yeah, because that's the same with anything. If someone has something, like, they obviously have the right to hoard it and, like, no one... like, show no one else, but it's, to be like, it's a good member of a community. If you have something, surely it makes more sense to share it. You get recognised as the person who shared that information.
And yes,
it's better for everyone at large, especially if it's music, because I don't know, with, like, the unreleased cuts from games, like beta content or cutscene. Well, for films, it's kind of like cutscenes from films. Can still watch it,
yeah,
but it can have a decreased audio, like, audio visual quality depending on how old it is. But music, it's most likely going to be in a good crisp quality,
yeah,
so that's good quality stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I think that,
and people want access to it.
Yeah, I mean, basically it was kind of a bit of a rallying cry for people, because it was like, the whole reason the guy basically leaked a load of stuff was because he was sick of people being elitist and being kind of purposefully hoarding stuff. Because I think when I originally had them before it got leaked, I even thought that, like, I felt bad not being able to share it with people. So I think that, you know, people hoarding it are just being really ridiculous.
Yeah, but you'll have also felt some sort of like, oh, I have this thing that no one else has, but more because you want this to be shared, because that's your opinion on getting things out. It's more, it's still, oh, I have this really cool Slipknot track, these really cool Slipknot tracks that no, like, hardly anyone else has. But also, people want to hear this and they can't hear it.
Yeah, all right. Cheers, mate.
Good for leaking it.
Yeah. Right, cheers, mate. Thank you. So that's basically getting you up to date with all the happenings in the Slipknot collector scene, apart from one thing that's happened very recently, and I'm talking in the last few weeks. So out of nowhere, this guy comes on the subreddit and basically says, my friend has a version of MFKR with a load of extra tracks on, notably two tracks called Viz Queen and Rites and Rage. And obviously, those are like mythical folklore within the Slipknot community, like Fur and Part of Me, because there was like photos of the CD and stuff, like we knew they existed, but like Viz Queen and Rites and Rage, people didn't even know whether there was even live recordings of those songs that existed.
In fact, up to that point, all we really had was a few words from Anders Karlsefni, who was the older lead singer of Slipknot, who would have been around when these songs were recorded. But even he couldn't really remember much about them.
Viz Queen, I would love to have a copy of that back. That was, I wrote that thing about, the lyrics anyway, about Paul and I pouring concrete and being on a driveway when it's raining and people holding plastic over our heads and we got concrete and cement and everything all over us and everything. That's what Viz Queen was about. We never really did anything with it because it was sort of a novelty song. We it started out with Joey on guitar and Sean was playing drums, and at some point I switch over onto drums and Sean gets on the microphone and whatnot. We tried doing it live a few times, but it was really kind of messy. Rites and Rage, that was like the second song that we wrote once we started the band up with Sean, Paul, I, and Donnie Steele.
And on top of that, there was a song they recorded for MFKR apparently called Wave Like the Pope, which was a ska song. And given the fact that the guy who had this new deluxe version, if you will, because it wasn't on his, I imagine it was cut quite early in development.
But like, so when this guy came on, obviously everyone was very, very sketchy, but a lot of people were almost kind of hoping for another Blackheart situation in a way. But then the guy came with photos and it turned out that this was legit and everyone went completely bonkers. Like people saying, oh, leak it, do a Blackheart, whatever. And then the guy basically went, you know, I'm my mate doesn't really know how stuff like this works and like he's a bit iffy about copyrights and we're not sure, which, you know, it raised a few eyebrows, but you know, we could kind of get it, but I am in contact with someone who, you know, may have Viz Queen and Rites and Rage. I'm not sure, but I am in talks with them currently. I'm also in talks currently with a guy who is said to have audio and video from the very first Slipknot gig. I believe it was under the name Meld in the Crowbar in 1995, so I'm in talks with them currently. I don't know whether anything like this is going to happen, but I'm saying if you've become interested in the Slipknot collector scene from this video, or you you know, you are in the Slipknot collectors community, if there are any developments at all, I'll all be posting them on the Slipknot subreddit, so go join that.
Right, it's me back again for the last time. When it comes to the guy with Viz Queen and Rites and Rage, I'm currently hoping that it'll direct me to someone to talk to, and turns out that was the same guy who had the Crowbar footage, but given that I don't have anything that hasn't already leaked to trade with him, he didn't want to give it to me. So hopefully he can redirect me to someone else I can talk to, or, you know, hopefully I can find someone else that maybe has Viz Queen and Rites and Rage. But, you know, in terms of the concert footage, sorry guys.
But yeah, that's about it for this video. So I hope you've enjoyed that, and who knows, maybe I'll do something like this in the future. It's definitely been fun. So, you know, if I ever have a topic that I'm particularly interested in, who knows, you might get another one of these. But for now, that's all from me. See you later.